The next item of business is topical questions. In order to get in as many members as possible, short and succinct questions and responses would be appreciated. And at question number one, I call Neil Bibby.
To ask the Scottish Government what discussions it's had with Loganair and Highlands and Islands airports regarding the suspension of many flights from 17 March.
Minister Jenny Gilruth.
It is disappointing that Loganair have suspended these routes, although I am hopeful for a resolution before the 17th of March. I met with the Chair and Managing Director of HAIL on Saturday morning to stress the need for a timely resolution to the pay dispute, and I asked for a new business case to be presented urgently to ministers. Following further discussions with unions yesterday morning, HAIL have developed further proposals which, subject to HAIL's board agreement, will be considered shortly by ministers. Transport Scotland officials have also discussed the situation with Loganair, which operates these routes on a commercial basis.
Neil Bibby.
The inescapable and scandalous fact is that the Scottish Government would still be sitting on its hands, ignoring the damage to the Highlands, if it had not been for the dramatic escalation threatened by Loganair. That's not how things should work. Cancer patients should not have to be subjected to fear in order to get a response from government. Islands should not be out of sight and out of mind until there is the risk of political embarrassment. Why has the Transport Minister suddenly discovered her role now, when she repeatedly refused to become involved over the past 5 months, while HAIL said their own hands were tied by the Scottish Government's pay policy?
Minister.
I think Mr Bibby has somewhat mischaracterised the situation. I meet with the unions across the transport sector on a regular basis, and most recently I met, of course, with our airline unions at the end of January to discuss this very matter. So it's not true to say that I've not been engaged throughout this process. And I do share Mr Bibby's concerns, which is exactly why, when this decision was communicated to me on Friday, I sought the first available opportunity to speak directly to HAIL on Saturday morning. Now, clearly there's a need for an urgent resolution to this dispute. I'm particularly concerned, for example, about any implications in relation to medical appointments. I think, as the member alluded to, that is a matter that I've asked Transport Scotland to raise directly with Loganair. Now, remember, this is, I think, important for members to recall. This is a decision by Loganair, and Loganair's view is that action short of a strike in the form of a work-to-rule leads to short-notice cancellation. So, for example, when staff absence can't be covered due to an overtime ban, Loganair have therefore taken the commercial decision in that respect because of the costs incurred by cancellations. But this is not a matter in which government ministers can become involved because the Scottish Government has no direct role in their provision.
Neil Bibby.
Many people in the Highlands and Islands believe that without Loganair's escalation, the Minister would still be missing, there would be no extra money on the table, and the indefinite prospect of cancellations and disruption would still be hanging over the Islands with no end in sight. The Minister cannot be unaware of the damage done to fragile island economies by the ferries debacle. Why, for the past 5 months, has she failed to prevent that damage being compounded by the ongoing disruption to island air services? If extra money can be found now, why could it not have been found last week or last month to avoid the massive disruption that has already taken place and the hundreds of hospital appointments that have already been cancelled?
Minister.
Again, I would refute Mr Bibby's characterisation of the situation. I meet with our trade union partners on a regular basis. It was the 31st of January that I last met with our airline partners in relation to this very matter, and I recognise that that dialogue was ongoing. Of course, I will again reiterate, Presiding Officer, this decision in relation to the cancellation of flights is not a decision that has been taken by government ministers, and nor is it one that I have any input in as a government minister. However, I did meet with HAIL on Saturday morning at the earliest opportunity to explain the urgency to them directly. HAIL met with the unions yesterday to discuss this new draft proposal. That proposal is now being put to the HAIL board, and I expect an urgent update on the new proposal later today. But the focus here for government ministers is absolutely on addressing the underlying issue, which of course is settling the HAIL pay dispute.
Alistair Allen.
Presiding Officer, it would be fair to say that my island constituents are horrified at Loganair's recent action. The impact on patients, including cancer patients alone, is almost unthinkable. Seriously ill people rely on this service to access treatment on the mainland, and it is unclear how operations, appointments and scans will be carried out otherwise. Loganair is a company which has directly and indirectly received substantial funding through the public purse and has now placed NHS Western Isles in an atrocious position. So did Loganair give the government or Island Health Boards any indication that such a disproportionate and draconian move by them was even being considered?
Minister.
I think in answer to the member's question, probably no. Loganair informed me of their decision, as I outlined in my response to Mr Bibby, on Friday morning to suspend, and that was obviously the decision to suspend these two routes that we're discussing today. Those services, though, as I explained to Mr Bibby, are commercial operate rather on a commercial basis, so it's not a matter in which government ministers can become involved. I very much understand the performance on the Stornoway to Inverness route has declined in recent times. In part, apparently, that is because of a reduction in travel by Western Isles Council staff, according to Loganair. That's been a major contributory factor, but also a reduction in relation to NHS staff who use ferries for patient travel. But I very much recognise the importance of these routes, and particularly in relation to these critical transfers, as the member has alluded to. I have asked my officials to speak directly to Loganair on that point.
Donald Cameron.
We now have a six-week suspension of Loganair flights. We've had a number of recent ferry failures, and we've had a betrayal of the SNP's promise to duel the A9. Travel to and from the Highlands and Islands is in crisis due to this government's failure to deliver adequate lifeline transport links. So when will this SNP Green government get its act together and make island transport a top priority?
Minister.
I don't accept the characterisation that Mr Cameron has outlined today in relation to transport to our islands and our island communities. The vast majority of my time, presiding officer, as Transport Minister, has spent dealing with these matters directly. I recognise the disruption on the network in recent times. I'm sure I'm about to answer a topical question further to that. However, it's important to reiterate that the way to resolve this situation with Hyle is to get a resolution between the unions and between Hyle. That's why I spent my morning on Saturday discussing with Hyle how they were urgently going to put forward a new proposal for ministers to approve. I await that proposal, and once I have it, we will be able to move forward and hopefully to unlock this dispute and provide greater reassurance to Mr Cameron's constituents.
Liam MacArthur.
Thank you. I was contacted earlier today by the family of a constituent to say their mother is booked to fly to Shetland for a mastectomy operation later this month. Due to the suspension of air services between Orkney and Shetland, she now faces either an 8-hour ferry journey the day after her operation or falling almost a week away from home. So does the minister accept that these are lifeline air services, and can she explain why Hyle bosses were required to stick to a 5% pay offer after counterparts at Calmac were freed up to offer staff more, and will she now ensure that everything possible is done to bring to an end this long-running and damaging dispute?
Minister.
I understand the sentiment behind the member's question. Of course, the scenario in relation to Calmac is slightly different to other public sector bodies. However, I recognise the concern that he's raised today. In relation to the constituent and their experience that he's outlined, I'd be more than happy to look at the specifics of that in detail. Clearly, these flights will operate on a commercial basis, and it's therefore very challenging for ministers to intervene in relation to their provision. Indeed, I raised this matter directly with Transport Scotland over the course of the weekend and again today. And whilst I'm not able to do that directly, I will make these representations to Loganair on behalf of Mr MacArthur and other members' constituents, because I do recognise the concern here.
Thank you. Question number two, Edward Mountain.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government, in light of the recent comments by the Chief Executive of CalMac, what action it is taking to prevent island residents being impacted by any reliability issues affecting their ferry services over the next 2 years?
Minister Jenny Gilruth.
I've been clear to Parliament and indeed to the NZEC Committee only last week that investment in new ferries to replace the existing fleet has been one of my key priorities as Transport Minister. We are delivering six new major vessels in the life of this Parliament, as well as the purchase of the MV Lough Frisa that's been in service on the Oban to Craignure route since last summer. We're investing almost £700 million to support the improvement in the fleet, and this will also allow investment in the small vessel replacement programme. And whilst I recognise that these vessels will take time to deliver, we're also investing in resilience funding of at least £4 million per year to maintain the existing fleet to continue the search, and we continue, of course, the search for additional tonnage that could be chartered in the short term.
Edward Mountain.
I thank the Minister for that answer. I'm absolutely flabbergasted by that. I asked in the next 2 years. There's obviously a timescale problem, the same timescale problem that is a result of a 10-year ferry plan that's been left on the shelf and ignored. As far as the resilience plans for the £4 million, the last time I'm aware that was spent, it was on improving fire extinguishers in a ferry, which should have been a normal contract thing. So where we are at the moment is we've got three First Minister's candidates, one who oversaw the ferries, one who signed off the payments to a turnaround director who failed to deliver, and one who appears to be content on building a doomsday thermometer for independence. Now, if the Transport Minister is still in position after this leadership battle, will she give me an assurance that a spare ferry will either be rented or purchased to cover the next 2 years?
Minister.
I'm more than happy to give Mr Mountain a confirmation in relation to that request. I think it's important to reiterate, Presiding Officer, that when I appeared in front of Mr Mountain's committee only last week, I gave a very clear guarantee in relation to the search for ongoing additional capacity on the network. And I again want to put on the record, of course, that CMAL have made offers to purchase two second-hand major vessels, so the MV Arrow and the MV Straitsman, which have unfortunately been unsuccessful. We will absolutely continue to look for the spare vessel that Mr Mountain has alluded to. I recognise very much so there is a challenge in relation to the current fleet and the availability of services at the current time. And I recognise too that, Mr Mountain will recognise too, that if there are ongoing conversations in relation to securing an additional vessel, some of those conversations will be commercially sensitive and I will not be as able as Minister to share some of that detail in the Chamber today. However, he has an assurance from me that we are absolutely seeking the additional tonnage that we so readily need in relation to the CalMac fleet.
Edward Mountain.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. So for the last 16 years, this government's been looking for a ferry to rent and haven't come across one. It might give them an indication that there aren't ferries out there, and they should have been building them, and they should have been building them in a much quicker process than they've been doing at the moment. So we've got the MV Pentelina, which will hopefully come onto a station to work. But that's just one extra ferry. So my question is very pointedly, so will 802 be on station and operational by early 2024 as has been announced by this government?
Minister.
Well, I think it's important to respond to Mr Mountain in relation to hiring or renting of vessels. Of course, we have currently chartered the MV Arrow, which is covering the UIG outage at the current time. So it's not true to say that the government has not considered these opportunities. And since May of 2021, the government has bought an additional vessel, so the MV Loch Frieda, which is operating on the Open to Craigmuir route. We've chartered the MV Arrow, as I alluded to. We've made significant progress in relation to the constructions of vessels 801 and 802. We've commissioned two new vessels for Islay. We've confirmed the award of contracts for two new vessels for the Western Isles on the Little Minterets, supported by an additional £115 million of investment. We've progressed investment in key ports and harbours, including, of course, the completion of major works at Tarbert and Harris. Now, clearly, ministerial responsibility for Ferguson sits within a separate portfolio, but we remain absolutely committed to the completion of those vessels and supporting our island communities that rely on that type of vessel.
Jenny Minto.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As the Minister knows, every cancelled sailing has impacts our island communities. Clearly, second-hand tonnage has a key role to play here, as the Minister has said. CMAL recently told the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee that it had looked at a substantial number of vessels. Can the Minister therefore set out some of the particular challenges of specification and suitability when it comes to trying to acquire additional tonnage for our ferry routes?
Minister.
As the member notes, CMAL has undertaken extensive searches and they continue, of course, to engage with shipbrokers to look at vessels available worldwide that would be potential additions to the CalMac fleet. There are a wide range of factors that CMAL need to consider when they're looking at vessels, including the fit for the specific characteristics of our harbours, the condition of the vessels itself, and also, importantly, whether the vessel will be compatible with the requirements of the MCA. We were able, of course, to secure the MV Loch Frieda, as I've alluded to, and as a result of those searches, and as I confirmed to committee last week, and I mentioned in my response, I think, to Mr Mountain, CMAL also made bids to purchase the MV Arrow and the MV Straitsman. Regrettably, we were not able to secure those vessels, but that does demonstrate, I think, our willingness to secure suitable new tonnage when it becomes available.
Katie Clark.
Does the Minister accept that the scale of the disruption being faced by islanders is a direct result of the Scottish Government's failure to adequately invest in new ferries since taking office? Bar the overdue ferries being built at Ferguson Marine, there still doesn't seem to be a strategy. In total, CMAL have examined 650 second-hand ships, most of which were found to be unsuitable. So will the Scottish Government commit to developing a long-term strategy to build capacity so we can build and commission vessels here in Scotland?
Minister.
Well, the first thing I would say in relation to Ms Clark's question is there is a strategy. The first part of the draft Islands Connectivity Plan published in December of last year, I would commend it to Ms Clark. She may want to look at that plan, but it sets out quite clearly the investment trajectory for this government in relation to the future. And secondly, in relation to investment, if you look at overall investment from this government since 2013-14 to 2022-23, there has been a steady increase in relation to investment for our ferry fleet. So it's simply not true to characterise this as a lack of investment from Scottish Government. So I would refute that point from Ms Clark. The most important thing now, presiding officer, for our island communities is that we deliver the ferries that are on order and improve, of course, the services that they are receiving. That's what I am focused on, absolutely, as Transport Minister.
Graeme Simpson.
Thank you. Ferguson Marine was facing being struck off because it hadn't filed its accounts on time. Can the Minister say, is there, as has been reported, an £11 million shortfall between what the firm has been asking for and what the government has agreed to give it, and will this impact on the building of ferries?
Minister.
I thank the member for that question. I think, as notified to the Public Audit Committee in December of last year, the Chief Executive of Ferguson's Marine expects the cost to complete both vessels to be £277 million, and Scottish Government officials, of course, are working closely with Ferguson's to review assumptions behind any revised costs and a schedule on how spend aligns to the vessel's delivery.
Thank you. Question number three, Fergus Ewing.
Presiding officer, to ask the Scottish Government, in the light of reports that small shops in Scotland fear that they cannot survive because of the costs and impacts of the Scottish Government's deposit return scheme, what its position is on Circularity Scotland's confirmation on 1st of March that retailers who use reverse vending machines would have to wait a full 1 month for payment for return bottles rather than the previously expected 7 days.
Minister Lorna Slater.
The retailer handling fee, which is the payment given to retailers to cover the costs of being a return point for Scotland's deposit return scheme, is the highest fee compared to other deposit return schemes around the world. The payment terms for all manual return point operators and hospitality venues will be 7 days, and the payment terms for larger locations that install automatic return points will be longer. Circularity Scotland has a wide membership of producers, trade associations and retailers. Any business with concerns should contact Circularity Scotland for advice and support.
Fergus Ewing.
Presiding officer, for the past 18 months, Circularity Scotland have in all their documents, on their website and in the presentations, confirmed that payment to retailers using reverse vending machines would be made in 7 days. Tens of millions, if not hundreds of millions, of pounds were invested on the basis of those commercial terms. Now that 7 day period has been extended to 1 month, a decision taken by Circularity Scotland with zero consultation with convenience stores, nor any explanation, nor any press release, hidden away in page 23 of this document here. So, three questions. First, does the Minister agree that this decision by Circularity Scotland was taken in both an underhand and a sleek-it fashion? Second, was she consulted on that decision? And third, will she now order Circularity Scotland Limited to rescind that decision?
I will remind members at this point of the requirement that supplementary questions should be brief. Minister.
To make the member aware of the context here, businesses offering return points in Scotland for Scotland's deposit return scheme have three options. They have the option, if they do not wish to apply to be a return point and they have a reasonable grounds for exemption, they can apply for an exemption and not act as a return point. Grounds for exemption may be on health and safety grounds, including a lack of storage, or on geographic grounds, in the sense that they are close to other return points that exist. The second option that businesses have is
Let's
to behave as
Minister.
A manual return point. This may be particularly suitable for small businesses, exactly of the type that the member is concerned about. Convenience stores who operate manual return points, who have a small volume of returns, would find that probably most convenient to them. And those small businesses, exactly the businesses that the member is concerned about, will have payments based on 7 days. Larger locations, for example, large supermarkets that have the capacity and need those automated vending machines to have that large capacity of return points, their payment terms will be longer. But that is very unlikely to affect the small businesses that the member is so concerned about. I will remind the member that this is an industry-led scheme, as was agreed across the chamber, and therefore the fees related to the scheme are a matter for industry to decide.
Fergus Ewing.
Presiding officer, businesses have been misled, duped and deceived by Circularity Scotland. There is irrefutable proof of that. The Minister has completely failed for the second week running to answer relevant, pertinent, vital questions. Can I ask again, was she consulted by CSL on this unwarranted, unheralded and non-consulted change from changing 7-day payment to 1-month payment, if indeed that's ever achieved under this scheme? Was she consulted, yes or no?
Minister.
Circularity Scotland is a private non-profit company and it is responsible for operating the scheme, including setting retailer handling fees. As set out in the DRS regulations, the Scottish Government is not involved in setting retailer handling fees. The fee was agreed after extensive knowledge-gathering exercise, which included analysis and modelling by PwC, which was appointed by the scheme members.
Maurice Golden.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. There are reports Circularity Scotland dismissed the contributions of small producers as just, and I quote, dust in the wind. This serves to make small producers feel the Scottish Government sees them as worthless. Many are already worried sick about the pig-headed planning of the scheme. But I would like to ask the Minister, was she consulted on retail handling fee changes, yes or no?
Minister.
I will give this member the same answer I gave previous member, which is, as set out in DRS regulations, the Scottish
Minister,
Government...
Sorry, Minister, if you just give me a moment. Members, I'm sure we would all wish to be heard with courtesy and respect when we're speaking. Please afford the Minister that courtesy. Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As set out in the DRS regulations, the Scottish Government is not involved in setting retailer handling fees.
Colin Smith.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. So, just for clarification, can the Minister just say whether or not she was consulted on the changes in those handling fees, yes or no? Because last week we heard producers give a resounding vote of no confidence in this scheme with less than 16% registered. This week, it's retailers that are expressing concern. Pete Chamer, the Scottish Grocers Federation, said the scheme was not fit for purpose and there's a real risk of thousands of stores closing due to cash flow issues or significant loss of footfall. Isn't it a damning indictment of the Minister's handling of this scheme that businesses, just 5 months before she says it will be introduced, have not been given that clear blueprint on what should happen with the introduction of that scheme? And the Minister still won't answer straightforward questions that members are asking.
Minister.
Businesses have indeed been given an operational blueprint that was published by or shared out by Circularity Scotland last week. Schemes of this type are in successful operation all over the world, and I will repeat what I've said earlier, is that the return handling fees are the highest in Scotland compared to other schemes around the world. Our businesses will do comparably better than other businesses around the world in comparable schemes. I'll repeat again that Circularity Scotland is a private non-profit company and they are responsible for operating the scheme, including setting retailer handling fees. The Scottish Government is not involved in setting retailer handling fees.
Mark Cruskell.
Thanks. It's crucial that we continue to support small retailers to participate in the DRS scheme, because not only will they be paid through the handling fee, but it will also be an opportunity for local shops to increase footfall. That's why the Federation of Independent Retailers are calling for there to be no delay to the scheme. So can the Minister outline what is being done to ensure retailers are aware of both their obligations, but also the opportunity that this scheme presents?
Minister.
I appreciate the member's question and also his highlighting of that those businesses who have invested in this scheme need this scheme to go live on August 16th, which is what the Scottish Government has committed to. Circularity Scotland has already contacted all retailers who have signed up for updates with information on the return point registration and exemption process. Retailers who have not signed up for these updates are encouraged to do so via the Circularity Scotland website. Circularity Scotland will also be sending a direct mail to approximately 10,000 retailers across Scotland with information about retailer registration and the exemption process. Circularity Scotland has been in dialogue with more than 1,000 individuals at physical and online roadshows across Scotland. They are also conducting regular meetings with trade associations representing retailers, wholesalers, drinks producers and hospitality.
And Christine Graham. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. The Minister says this is industry-led, but I have in my hand a letter published on the 6th of March and signed by Inter Alia, Director of CBI Scotland, Policy Chair of FSB, Chief Executive of Scottish Chamber of Commerce, Chief Executive of SCDI and many others, and hundreds of individuals who describe DRS in its current form as reckless. Will the Minister at very least instruct Circularity Scotland to remove glass from the current recycling scheme?
Minister.
Scotland's deposit return scheme, which will go live in August this year, will collect glass. Glass is one of the main three materials used to make single-use containers and accounts for more than a quarter of all the containers due to be included in our deposit return scheme. Of the 44 territories operating deposit return schemes in the world, only four of them do not include glass. Glass is one of the most common items to pollute our beaches, and broken glass poses a hazard to the public and wildlife. It also poses a threat to local authority, private sector, and voluntary cleanup crews. Including it in the DRS will help reduce the amount of littered glass. The Scottish DRS business case suggests that including glass will save over 1.2 megatons of CO2, equivalent over 25 years, and will significantly increase the quantity and quality of glass recyclate.
Thank you. That concludes topical questions. Point of order, Stephen Kerr.
Presiding Officer, in the interest of those who have just watched, particularly that last topical question, and listened to the answers, so-called answers that the Minister has offered, can you clarify for the viewing audience and for all of us, does a minister who's asked questions in this parliament have an obligation in any sense to address the question they're being asked? Because what we have heard this afternoon is four occasions at least when a minister was asked a very direct question and on every occasion refused to give a clear answer. Surely that is not acceptable. Surely that is a disrespect to this parliament.
Thank you, Mr. Kerr. While standing orders are silent on this particular issue, it is, of course, a matter of courtesy and respect to all members that responses to questions put address the questions that were put. There is also a requirement, of course, under the Ministerial Code on this issue.